Thank you so much for inviting me to speak to all of you this evening, and thank you everyone for joining us on a weekday evening to really hear about my story for the last 15 years now. But I thought I'd share with you this evening about the different animals I've met in the last 15 years. Really stories about them, how they've touched my life, how they've changed my life over my work in Acres, and how really we've tried our very best here in Singapore, in Laos, in Australia, in Thailand, in Malaysia, where we work at, how we try our very best to change their lives as well, change their destiny, change their future. But I'll start with a video. It is slightly old video, but I still like this video the best. So it's a 2011 video. So we are not 11 years old this year, but we are 15 already. Quite nice to realize that, but in the last 5 years, so that number has grown to now over 4,000. These are really 4,000 wild animals, because we focus mainly on wild animals. We don't do dog and cat rescue. We really rescue the native wildlife, as well as really campaign for something we call industrialized animal cruelty. So cruelty that goes on behind the scenes and on a massive or industrial scale. So not just kicking a dog, I think a lot of us will agree it's cruel. But for a lot of the issues that Acres focuses on, it's something that you don't really see the inherent cruelty. A lot of it you might be involved in, but you really not necessarily know. And so we've broken down into six focus areas, as Denise mentioned. And I've broken down the stories into these six focus areas. So really giving you a glimpse of each area, some of the animals I've met while we work on these areas as well. And the first really is zoo animal welfare. And we're not against zoos. We're against practices like this. This tiger's name was Simba. Simba lives in a tiny little cage about the size of him. And every night he's taken out for photography. And every night they beat him up. They chain him up. If you look close enough, you realize he's panting a lot as well. That's because they drug him with ketamine, so he's panting a lot. And ketamine so that he can't react fast enough to bite people. You realize he tries to lie down. A little bit into the clip, they will beat him up again to make sure that he sits. And that was his entire life. Come out of this tiny little cage, chained up for photography, take a photo, beaten up, at night he goes back into the cage. But in all our focus areas, what we try to do is work together at times with the zoo or work with the government. In this case, we work with the Malaysian government. At least we're pleased that Simba has been rescued and this zoo has actually been shut down. After 10 years of campaigning, we finally were successful in getting legislation in Malaysia. So we had the first legislation in Malaysia where the welfare of zoo animals is now looked into, and people are now being prosecuted for cruelty offences in zoos. And I think we are one of the only NGOs where the Malaysian government actually invites us to do joint inspections. So we're from a campaign to now working closely with the Malaysians. I'm going now to do the actual inspections, going now to meet the zoo owners to make sure that they comply with the new legislation now. But we offer work in Singapore as well. We work very closely with the Singapore Zoo. But with Resorts World, unfortunately, we haven't managed to get that kind of relationship we have with the zoo, where if you make a complaint to me about the Singapore Zoo, we can go there, meet with the CEO, share what the complaint is, go and do the inspections, make recommendations, and things are changed. But with Resorts World, we've tried our very best to engage them. I hope you know, 27 dolphins were caught from the wild in the Solomon Islands. They were transported to Singapore. 4 of the dolphins have since passed away. Wen was one of them. We've done a number of campaigns that I can't elaborate within the next few minutes, but ultimately, we've done a survey that shows that Singaporeans are very much against this. This was actually an independent survey done by Millward Brown. And in fact, the rest of the world in progressive countries are also against this. In the United Kingdom, the last dolphin was released in 1993. And this was done on a voluntary basis. There was no government legislation, but people or the marine parks that kept the dolphins realized one day that they shouldn't be in captivity. And they voluntarily released them back into the wild. In Costa Rica, it's actually a criminal offense to keep dolphins in captivity. And the latest country that joined this list is India. It is now illegal to keep dolphins in captivity. In fact, all marine animals in captivity in India now. And that's something that we have been pushing for. As we progress, let's just not focus purely on economics, but also focus on moral progress.
I feel it's not right for, you know, people outside from this country to come and check our dolphins and making a huge amount of money outside. It's not right. In real terms, they've been stolen out from our country.
As you watch this video, Solomon Islands has since banned the export of dolphins from their country. So no more captures, no more exports.
Dealers who came in, they used the local people to catch the dolphins.
I caught the dolphins from the outside sea because we do driving dolphin hunting. We drive them all the way from the ocean and get them to the shore.
Most of the dolphins were caught along the coastal shore of Guadalcanal Canal, and then they were brought over to the Gavutu. They kept them there for about six months to a year, and after that they export the dolphins to those various places.
I've been to Gavutu Island where Chris Porter kept all these dolphins. Once he kept more than 100 dolphins at a time. And the second time I went there, it went down as far as 20 animals. And within that time, there was not an export being done. So that's exactly, absolutely telling us that mortality rate is high. But they can't live in those conditions. The waters that this facility is set upon is so very shallow.
They got sick. So I heard that quite a number of them died.
These dolphins are from our seas and they are from our waters. And when they take them away, they die abroad.
The truth is, we have our dolphins that used to swim in our waters are swimming in fences. Really, the people of Solomon Islands are lost.
I mean, the population of this species is very rare.
Some of the employees, they were not paid up until now. Some of the fishermen who brought these fish to feed the dolphins, they were not paid. The reefs surrounding the Gavutu Islands were damaged by dynamite fishing. The fish were caught to feed the dolphins.
The local people did not benefit. The one who export dolphin under the trade business, he benefit or I don't know.
In fact, one of the major threats these dolphins face in the wild this life captures for Oceania. Which is why we said this was one of the biggest irony where we took these dolphins to Singapore to tell people that we need to protect dolphins. But at the same time of taking them, we've contributed to perhaps a local extinction now in the Solomon Islands.
Or for resources.
But such an industry will only ruin the natural environment of different places in the world. We are destroying the very friendly, wise animals, even think and can understand like a human being. We have to defend the speechless.
As I told you, I'll put little snippets of each area. Our next really is cruelty-free living. So can anyone tell what's happening to the rabbit? Cosmetic testing, yes. So this is what we call a DRACE test. Any product that you see made in China, that is a foreign company, and you buy it, you would have contributed to this. And so what they do is they get, say, about 1,000 rabbits thereabouts. They drip the products. So the product that you want to sell in China, they drip it into the eyes of the rabbit to see whether it burns the rabbit's eyes. This is not a voluntary test. This is actually by legislation. It is a mandatory process. And what they also do is what they call a skin irritancy test. So they also shave the fur of the rabbit and drip the products onto their skin, see whether it burns the rabbit's skin as well. And this is something that a lot of groups have been campaigning to not just end, but to find an alternative, which has happened in EU already. So something like this, which the DRACE test, is now a criminal act in the whole of EU. And even if you now test your products outside EU and you want to sell it in EU, it's now also, it's not allowed anymore. And that's something that we are pushing for in China. We have been successful with one big step forward, in that China has now said that with the local companies, they do not need to now do this test anymore. Only the foreign companies, the foreigners that want to bring products into China, will still have to carry out this test. Sounds a bit weird, but at least that's still one positive step forward where less rabbits are being tested on now. If you go to the Acres website, you can also find our cruelty-free shopping guide. So that will tell you which products is safe to buy. Or it now it's made it very easy now in that any product that you see made in the EU, you can now buy it. It's safe. We go a lot, as Denise mentioned, we go a lot to the schools. We go a lot on public roadshows. To really reach out to people, not just empower them with knowledge, but most importantly, inspire them to join us, to make a difference. There are a lot of volunteers as well, a lot of volunteer opportunities, not as much as the 30 that you have, but we have some as well, and volunteers contribute about 12,000 volunteer hours every year. In fact, volunteers are the main pillar of Acres now. With all the work that we do, from the wildlife rescue, tonight we will have volunteers helping out 24/7, our wildlife rescue services run. And that's really now meant by volunteers. And I threw a challenge to the Acres team quite a number of years ago where I told them twice a year we actually do an overseas retreat, 3 days, 2 nights. And the challenge for the Acres staff was for 3 days, 2 nights, the entire Acres operation will be run by volunteers. From the wildlife rescue to the wildlife crime to the animal care, everything will be run by volunteers, and we've been successful so far. Of course, the directors panic whenever we leave the country. But so far, it's been successful in getting volunteers to run the entire Acres operation. We also focus next on wildlife crime. I hope you know about shark's fin. But at one point, Singapore was the top 5 country in the world in terms of consumption. In terms of import-export, we were number 2 in the world. And every year, we kill about 700 million sharks for their fins and for their meat. And so a large proportion was coming to Singapore for consumption, for import-export. And some of the studies done, we realized there was a correlation, because the higher the number of wedding dinners for that year, the higher the amount of shark's fin imported. That's the reality. Business meals and wedding dinners were basically wiping out this species. A lot of people think this is something of the future where sharks will be wiped out, but in the Northwest Atlantic waters, it's already happened. the shark population has declined by 95% now. It's almost wiped out already. It's not just a conservation issue, it's also a welfare issue. So a lot of the fishermen use long line. And a lot of times, so the shark is dragged out of the ocean alive, they cut off the fin, and then they kick the shark back into the ocean. Terribly cruel process, because without the fin, the sharks can't really swim properly, and then they drown. They literally drown in their own homes. So we've done this video. Easy to also release this in the China market, which we've done. It's gone viral. In Hong Kong, it's gone viral. And with the Shark's Fin campaign, and I'll start more positive stuff now, we have, the tide has really turned. And that was, we're thankful to, at the end of a 10-year campaign, it was actually a shark's fin trader that brought an end to this industry. I'm not sure if you remember, a number of years ago, a shark's fin trader posted on Facebook, and I can't remember the exact words, but I think he said, "Screw the divers, we're going to sell shark's fin at NTUC this Chinese New Year." And that started a whole storm of protests against NTUC. Xia Jinping in the end removed shark's fin from the shelves of NTUC. Cold Storage followed, Carrefour followed, and all of a sudden that swept through almost the entire industry. Hotels started to follow, Shangri-La has stopped, MBS has stopped, and I think very proudly Singapore Airlines is not just, they used to serve it in their first class, shark's fin soup, but they're not just stopped serving, but they've now decided to also stop transporting. So for SIA cargo, if you have shark's fin in your consignment, they will not ship the cargo, the consignment for you. And that's quite a big step forward already. But unfortunately, the whatever I just told you, the trade is still legal. 700 million sharks slaughtered every year is still a legal trade. But even in terms of the illegal wildlife trade, which I'll show you some of the things that we have done in Singapore, we're still top 10 in the world. Top 10 because we're quite a big transshipment hub. If you look at Solomon Islands, where a lot of times they don't really have many birds, they don't even have the birds of paradise, but they have, are one of the largest exporters of birds, and the largest importer from Solomon is Singapore. From Singapore, it goes to the rest of the world. But it's not just the birds. We've done surveys into the trade in tiger parts as well.
Tiger teeth.
And we were entirely shocked because in this undercover that we did in Singapore, we found 59 shops selling tiger parts.
That is also for protection.
In total, we found 500 tiger parts on sale in Singapore shops.
Do you think we might like it?
So that ranged from tiger skin, tiger teeth, tiger claws. And I think, you know, with tigers, they are going to go extinct. India, the population is rebounding, but tigers are now being killed so that you can put the skin in your pocket and magically you become more powerful. That's it. That's scary, you know. And you wear the tiger teeth, the belief is that you become more powerful. All the tigers now slaughtered just because of this belief. Of course, tiger bones as well.
Same tiger.
But
this is real, is it? Real.
Yes, yes, yes.
Oh,
genuine.
A genuine tiger.
Yeah.
This
is
prayer. Oh, okay, okay. He is
in Thailand.
Thailand.
And what shocked us the most was that majority of the shopkeepers actually knew it was illegal.
How much is each one?
And yet they carry on the practice.
80 per piece. But can
I love it when you say that.
Can keep
like for protection, authority, all this.
But she's going to bring it out of Singapore. Can bring it out?
Okay, if you like bring it out, you can put it in your bag.
But it's no problem, right? Because someone here told us that don't bring it out of Singapore.
Bring out, just say it's just a talisman. I don't say it's really a tiger fur or what.
Didn't consider getting that, but
the positive of this is
to
that that resulted in the largest seizure of tiger parts in Singapore today.
Okay.
We worked with AVA.
No.
Every shop was raided.
But do you get more?
We followed up with a survey just last year, I believe.
Do you get more?
So from 59 shops, which is quite a high percentage. I'm sorry, I can't remember the exact percentage. But in the last survey that we've done, it's now only about 2 or 3% of shops selling. So we've effectively wiped out this trade in Singapore now. And we continue to do this. So we just set up the Animal Crime Investigation Unit. If you saw with our media releases a couple of months ago, we have been focusing now on sting operations. So really wiping out the remnants of the trade. Now, if you try to sell these things online or in the shops, you will never know whether it's an ACUS undercover. We wear the hidden camera, we work with AV as well, where we do controlled deliveries. So NUS has done a study for us. Whenever we do a sting operation, online the trade goes completely quiet. Nobody dares to sell. And then a few months later, it reappears again. Then we do the sting again. And so hopefully we send the message out now that we are serious in clamping down. AVA is serious in prosecuting and making sure the offenders are brought to task as well. The next really is something that's very close to my heart, which is called bear farming. How many of you have heard of bear farming? A couple of you. But I learned about bear farming really when I started ACUS in 2001. And I brought myself to visit a bear farm in 2009, so about now 7 years ago. And I'll show you some of the footages. It's probably one of the most depressing things I've ever seen. But this was the absolute first bear that I met in a bear farm. First bear because she was left at the entrance to the farm, and this was in Northern Lao. When I walked in, I asked the farmer, why did you leave her there? And he told me that she stopped eating, so leave her there to die. The bears are actually kept in these small cages because they are farmed for their bao, which is used as a traditional Chinese medicine. And they live in these cages for about 10 years. It's a coffin-like cage. The size of the cage is the size of the bear. But I always share this story because it's amazing. When I sat down beside her, the only thing she wanted me to do was to stroke her paw. The only thing she wanted to do was to hold my hand as well. You put a human in there for that number of years you approach, they will spit at you, they will grab you, they want to kill you. But you put a bear there for all these years and you torture her. And all she wants is affection. The first bear that I saw in the bear farm is also the first bear that I literally watched pass away. We filmed it, I won't show you that, but she took her last few breaths and she died. But that was the first choice she made. Never chose to be in a bear farm, but she chose to end her life because our vet was there. Her stomach was empty, she literally starved herself to death. This is a typical bear farm. Because we take the bowel away from the bear, which is used for digestion, same as us humans, the bears will live on almost a liquid diet for the rest of their lives. You're asked how many bears live like this? About 10,000 in China, 4,000 in Vietnam, 1,400 in Korea, about 100 in Laos. All the empty cages you see, there were bears in there previously. They all died in these conditions. The behaviors you see the bears performing are the same behaviors you will see in psychiatric hospitals for humans. You go to Woodbridge now, especially the next behavior, the walking round and round, what we call pacing, you will see that we humans do the exact same thing. In very simple layman terms, these bears have gone mad. Every single bear that you see also was caught from the wild. And studies now show there are more bears in bear farms than there are left in the wild already. We're literally wiping out this species so that we can drain them of their bao. But we've been working in Lao now for about 7 years. And the same thing as what I started with, we're not there to criticize the Laotians. That is, why would they be involved in such cruel practices? But we're there to work with them now. One, to find alternative livelihoods for the people involved in this. Two, to show the government that there is alternative. 50% of the people that go to Lao are eco-tourists. They don't want to see bears like this. They want to see bears in the wild. And we're in the process now of setting up a new sanctuary where we can start rescuing these bears and releasing them back into the wild. It's going to be a crazy process. Majority will not make it. Majority will have to be euthanized because they're so badly infected from the incision they make into the gallbladders. But we're there also to help other animals. So, like the monkeys. A lot are also captured from the wild for the illegal pet trade. This guy we just rescued is trying his very best to find my chest hair, but Chinese man got no chest hair. So they love to groom. That's a sign of affection actually. So when he does that, he's actually saying that he likes me. But couldn't give him my chest hair, so we got him a stuffed toy instead. And I'll share more positive stories now. But with monkeys, they actually have a smile as well. So you see him do his... He'll give a little grin. That means they are happy. And they have their own facial expressions. Very similar to humans as well. And like us, they like their mummies. And he used to sleep with this stuffed toy for quite a bit of time. He would cuddle the fella. So if you see the Acres logo, it's actually a blue monkey. And it's actually this monkey. 12 years ago, I got the call on our Acres office, our phone, and someone told me that someone was keeping this monkey in a factory in Tuas. We called AVA, we went down and we raided the place, we confiscated Blue, we named him Blue, but Blue is actually a vervet monkey that came all the way from South Africa. He was caught from the wild, like the baby bears you saw, but his is a little bit more horrendous. They would have to shoot his entire family. The entire troop was slaughtered. He came on board a ship from Cape Town, South Africa, all the way to Singapore. He spent 6 years like this, caged up, looked close enough, he realized he's chained up as well. And that was the first shock that I got, because after we confiscated him, AVA turned to me and said, Louis, actually we don't have a home for Blue. We don't have a facility for monkeys, a government facility. So if you don't mind, Louis, could you bring him home for a couple of days till we decide what to do? So still living with my parents back then, mommy wasn't exactly pleased when I came home that day with an African monkey, with AVA enforcement in tow as well, to make sure that he's kept well. So he stayed with me for a couple of days, but after that, AVA called me back and said, look, the zoo didn't want to house him. Nobody could care for him, so bring him back. We're going to have to euthanize him. We're going to kill him. And I thought that wasn't the solution at all. After all that he's been through, surely once we rescue him, we should give him a second chance. How can we possibly end this whole story with killing him? And so we managed to get the approvals. We raised the funds through public donations. And we sent him back to the Mundawanga Sanctuary in Zambia. That's Blue now sticking his tongue out at you. And we introduced him to this girl called Tony, who was rescued in Zambia. But they fell in love, so if you saw the monkey grooming me, what Blue did was he started to approach Tony to groom her as a sign of affection, almost saying that, would you like to be my girlfriend? He was successful, and they have two kids, Indigo and Sapphire. They have since actually, the whole family has been released back into the wild. And that's a happy story, which is why he is the logo for Acres now. To show people that for all the wrong that we have done to these animals, we still have a chance to right this wrong. To give him back a second chance at life and a second family. And doing this work, I think you've seen a lot of footage. Now everybody says that, why do this? The animals never say thank you, but it's never about the thank you. But the animals actually do have their own special way. I actually flew with Blue. One person had to escort him all the way to Zambia. We made quite good conversations on the plane and at the immigration and customs. Because I was there for one night only, and it was, what are you doing here? I said, bringing a monkey back. And they couldn't believe me, but I followed him all the way there. And just before I left, he made a sound, which basically means he wants to groom. That was the last shot. He was grooming almost as a sign of affection. But the people that used to keep him in the factory in Tuas, they showed us all the wounds. They were nothing but bite wounds, but somehow, animals know when you're doing something good for them. Because of Blue, I had an idea. This footage is not so clear. When I was much younger, we filmed this. But something beautiful happened. I think this was Generation Next that was filmed by HSBC for Arts Central. But they asked me what my dream was, and I said was to open a rescue center in Singapore.
For the animals where they can sort of retire in peace.
It's slightly dramatic, but they made me do this.
We're envisioning it to be very natural. So we build it, it will look just like this, except that.
And at that point, the producer just said, look, we just need to choose somewhere green. So choose a spot in Singapore, any spot, and we'll just film there and say that you want to build a wildlife rescue center. I think this is the first time you'll be hearing this, but somehow I chose this spot, and somehow when government says, okay, we're going to allocate you a piece of land, it somehow turned out to be this exact spot. So for those of you that have been to Acres, this was actually the start. This was actually 2 years before we got the piece of land. Somehow, fate had it that we filmed at where we were going to build. And today, as you've heard, we rescued over 4,000 animals. We don't house dogs and cats, but mainly wild animals rescued or confiscated from the illegal wildlife trade, as well as injured native wild animals. I'll start really the last part of my talk, which is really why I've done what I've done for the last 14 years. Why exactly did I do it? At 14, I watched a documentary about how people were saving turtles in the wild. And something just clicked when I realized that not only was I not part of the solution, but I was part of the problem. Because I love to drink turtle soup, just to buy from Chom Chom. But somehow it clicked, and at 14, I took my first step towards making a difference, which quite simply was give up turtle soup. I watched a lot more documentaries, gave up shark's fin, but the real turning point came when I watched a movie called Gorillas in the Mist that told the life story of Diane Fossey, this American lady who left her good life in America to go to Africa to save gorillas. I watched that movie with my mom, I think, who curses the day that she let me watch that movie. But halfway through, I turned to her at 14 and I said, Mommy, I want to be just like Diane once I grew up. Mommy, of course, freaked out because at the end of the movie, Diane was murdered by the poachers. And she thought, oh my God, Louis wants to do this when he grows up. But I told her that was where my passion was. And I started to read up more. I volunteered at the SPCA. I did my degree in biology, did my master's as well. And along the way, I also volunteered at the Singapore Zoo. I did get very close to this chimp called Ramba, who was a when I met her, I was about a year old, about two, thereabouts. But I got very close to her, and she got very close to me as well. If they go chimps, they actually laugh. And they love it. But something she really didn't like was photography. And quite a number of times, she used to misbehave. She'd come down from the bench, and to train her, the keepers, behind the scenes, they used to grab her by her head, manhandle her, and then they punch her in the face. At one point, she was punched. She ran to me, she hugged me, and she did this to check whether her lips were bleeding. It happened the second time before I realized again I wasn't part of the solution, but I was part of the problem. I spoke up, went up to the zoo management, spoke up to him and I said, we got to end this practice, and he fired me. Word for word, he told me, you're just a small boy, you'll never win. And with that, he took my badge, told me to leave the zoo, don't ever come back again. But I decided I would campaign, not just for Ramba, but for the two other photography chimps as well. One was Poco, one was Gombe. And I'll share with you one last story of Poco, a two-year-old male chimpanzee. At the photography mall, we gave him two bananas. And you know, they liked the bananas. He ate one, he held on to the other one, and we thought, okay, maybe not hungry now, he'll eat it later. We locked him back in his cage, and beside Poco lived a mandrill called Gurmit. Different species, but also a primate. But what Poco did really floored us, me and the other keeper, because he put his hand out with the banana and he passed it to Gurmit. And I thought how amazing it is that 2 hours ago, this little boy could think that maybe I should save this for Gurmit, not even his family, not even the same species, but somehow he did it. And so it was 1999, I decided I would campaign for their freedom. I approached the Straits Times. Somehow the reporter Eunice believed in my story. With no absolute proof, she published it. They gave us prime news. People started to write into the zoo, urging them to stop this practice. And after about 3 years of campaigning, the chimps won. The zoo invited me back for the release of Ramba. Release of Ramba, Poco and Gombe. Release because they took Ramba away from her mother when she was about a year old. So for about 3 years, she never saw her mother. Maybe could smell, maybe could hear her, but never touch. But the minute they opened the gates, they released Ramba, she ran to her mother. And that's actually a Straits Times photo with, I think they captioned it, Ramba on your right, reunited with Susie on your left. And remember, the grooming part is actually the mom grooming the daughter. I think the Straits Times asked me for a quote in 2001, and the quote that they published was, this was the best thing I've done in my life. They asked me what's next, and I told them that I was going to set up this group called Acres. If I could devote that few years of my life to save three chimps, I could obviously do more if I devote more of my life towards this. Ramba has since passed away, probably one of the worst days of my life. She escaped from the zoo enclosure. The zoo darted her, she fell into the Salita Reservoir and she drowned. It was a horrible end for a chimp who obviously deserves so much more and who taught me so much as well. But if you ask about Acres, she really is the inspiration behind the setting up of Acres. I was a second year undergraduate at NUS when I set this up, and I always remember my mom telling me, She told me word for word, Louis, if you go down this path, you're going to die alone. My mom's civil servant. She said, nobody in Singapore will support you, you know. No money. Where's the money in this? But I always tell the youth, and I always use this quote, which reads, I am only one, but still I'm one. I cannot do everything, but still I can do something. And because I cannot do everything, I will not refuse to do the something that I can do. And that's what I told my mom. Probably I can't do everything and save them all, but at least I can do something. If not me, then who? If not now, then when? Eventually, my mom bought it. She is still supporting us, Acres now. My dad was very supportive as well. But ultimately, in the last now 15 years, if there's one thing I've learned that nothing is impossible. Miracles take time. We set up Acres. The first registered Acres office was my parents' home address. We started really small to now where we have a team of very dedicated people, about 20 full-time staff members who go to work every day to make a difference. A lot of them are professionals. A lot of them are post-grad students. We have a lawyer who used to be a partner of a law firm that has joined us now, probably take an 80% pay cut. But people who are deeply passionate about making a difference. People who are deeply passionate about making sure that the impossible becomes possible. I show that little pig model. If you go to Acres, you still see it there. Because when I had the first idea of opening a rescue center in Singapore, the first person I approached at the government, and he told me that, Louis, if you can get this place going, pigs will fly in Singapore. Why would you think the government will give you land for something with no economic value, for something that is for animals? But we fought hard. In fact, today the media was asking, 2004, we got the approval from AVA after a year of campaigning, and in 2009, we officially opened the rescue center. It took us 6 years from the time we had the idea to the time where we had our opening ceremony. But we essentially showed in the last 15 years that really nothing is impossible. Pigs can fly in Singapore. Because I became an MP now, but I remain the same person who will continue to speak up, who will continue to speak my mind, who will take animal welfare into the next chapter now to make sure that these issues are not just discussed in the public arena, but also discussed in Parliament. I'll end the last slide. Do join us on Facebook. There's a donation tin out there. We're raising funds for Acres today. If you can, please donate. But last but certainly not least, is I hope that whatever that you've heard me talk about today, you spread the word. And that's essential to making sure that all the cruelty that you saw today can come to an end. Only a handful of you raised your hand when I asked about bear farming. But if you imagine over 15,000 bears live like that, and yet, majority of people here in Asia don't know that that happens. If nobody knows it happens, nothing will change. If nobody speaks up about it, nothing will change as well. And if nobody starts to raise all these issues, then governments wouldn't change and policies wouldn't change. So please help spread the word. But if not, thank you so much for inviting me. Thank you so much for your attention.
Thank you so much. Thank you, Louis.